In those days, Australia was so stitched up, there were so many things to rebel against.
There was this horrible dead conservatism, and Robert Menzies was around, and it was such a sort of grey, thin time to be young. And it was obvious something had to explode, and it all did explode. And in Australia, it was Martin and Richard who sort of, I think, sort of popped the cork with Oz.
Throughout its brief history, beginning early last year, Oz has been something about which few people are neutral.
What are you trying to get at with the magazine? What are your targets?
Well, they're wide and varied, but they're ignorance and intolerance and corruption, generally.
I think we were just very pissed off with the way Australia was. There was no free speech at the time. And in fact, the very, very first issue of Oz magazine was prosecuted. Like, we'd hardly got it out, and there was nothing we really could see in it that would freak anyone out. Not even my mother, who was much more conservative than me.
It was just so funny and so clever and so naughty. And it just changed everything.
Every edition of Oz was great fun. And it was very exciting at that time. And it was inevitable they'd go too far or tread on somebody's toes.
But I think we published a few things that were caused some problems. We sort of published, I think, in a sort of innocence, you know, but not realising the impact that it would have, or the people who would be rubbed up the wrong way.
The magazine was mostly Martin. He was the art director. And he was just, you know, firing. He was exploring all sorts of graphic ways.
This one with Buffett on the cover, like, but I don't give a stuff about opera. This is where, in this digital age, when people really rediscover some of Martin's art in these magazines, they are going to flip. Because young people don't know it. Look, just the handwriting, unbelievably beautiful. Unbelievably. And just, you know, such a cynic. Then here we are, I was rolled by the stones. Well, he had to get back at me.
Without Martin, you know, I don't think Oz would have achieved what it was able to achieve. It was just exactly what made the magazine something very original.
And then, of course, Richard and Martin went to London. Everyone went.
I was very keen to live in Chelsea. King's Road, London, etc. was exciting.
We went from black and white to the full grid. Yeah, colours bounding out of the sky. And it was sex and drugs and rock and feminism, and all these themes were starting to, yeah, they were on the boil.
While he was in England, you know, his stuff was coming back here in Oz magazine, and he was submitting things to newspapers and magazines, so you really were aware of his development.
Well, he was at the forefront of it all, really, reshaping art for a more populist generation. There was a Mick Jagger issue, and that is a fantastic cover, Mick, you know, prancing around. But then, of course, you know, something else was happening beyond the music. People were smoking dope, you know, puffing cigarettes, and so that was changing things a little bit. And then Timothy Leary was rising out of America, and you know, Turn On, Tune In, Drop Out, and Martin got caught up in that too. He was very interested in that, in rearranging people's consciousness in a way, being, you know, certainly a serious adventurer into those realms. And there was a particularly brilliant, my favourite issue of London Oz, You've Got Nothing to Lose But Your Mind, like it was a much more kind of intrusive, interesting adventure into consciousness.
I was, I think, living just off of Regent's Park in the 60s. It was probably around the end of 65, 66. I had started dating a French model that I was very keen on called Charlotte. Charlotte introduced me to Martin because I think he was dating a friend of hers. I couldn't quite figure out his style, and I'd never met an Australian before either. I mean, and there was a quite, it was a full-on kind of meeting on a lot of levels. But I liked him instantly.
He was cutting an album at the time. I had no idea who Eric Clapton was. Yeah, that's how I was ignorant in that way. And I think perhaps that's one of the reasons we got on, you know.
I had this sort of descending bass line thing that I was playing around with. And he said, this would sound great with this poem I've written, you know.
You thought the leaden winter would bring you down forever, but you rode upon a steamer to the violence of the sun.
And I just loved the scanning of the poem. It was so easy to fit to the meter of what I'd written that it was instant, you know, it was instant.
And you touch the distant beaches with cares of great Ulysses, how his naked ears were tortured.
His work at that time was the perfect visual expression of what was going on in the music. Not only did he write songs for The Cream, but you know, did their record covers. So it was just a wonderful combination.
The whole thing was sort of like on a photograph. He worked on top of the photograph.
Their music had a very warm, electric sound. And that's what I tried to capture with that album cover. I never thought it would be a successful album cover or anything as it has been.
So psychedelia had not actually appeared anywhere, really. It was occurring with people taking acid and having hallucinations, but it wasn't being expressed in music. It was, but visually it had yet to be really established as a movement. Martin's use of collage and color and all of that had not really happened yet. So simplistic, but and miles ahead of their time.
It had come out of pop art and it had become psychedelic through influence of drugs and drug culture. He was the right person in the right place at the right time.
His Jimi Hendrix was the Jackson Pollock painting of the 60s, really. It's got that edge that will sum up in another 100 years' time. You know, people will look and say, ah, that's what the 60s was about, because it sort of says it all visually.
Dillawan, Mr. Tambourine Man, became an instant icon. It was recognised instantly as a masterpiece and grabbed by museums, which at the time had just begun to collect contemporary posters.
There was the Pheasantry where Martin lived and Eric lived. People like Germaine was living downstairs, Germaine Greer, writing the female eunuch at the time. And then Martin had the sort of whole top floor.
So Martin had his bedroom, which you wouldn't have believed. You wouldn't have believed like that. The wallpaper, and there was like one huge montage of photographs and art and that, like that he'd done, you know, and it was mind-boggling. And a lot of bright silver and gold and red and yellow paint everywhere. I was very, very curious about it. I was kind of quite mildly obsessed because he was a fantastic ladies man. You know, he had women queuing up. So, I mean, it was just wall to wall. You know, the girls would be coming out of his bedroom and going home. And another one would be, like, you know, half an hour later, another one would go in. We were doing a lot of smoking and drinking wine and stuff, like getting pretty stoned, or at least just copping a buzz.
My most memorable visit to Martin in those early days in King's Road was having a cup of tea with him. And after a few moments, I said, this tea tastes funny. And he had done it. He had put LSD into my teapot. It was interesting. I don't regret it.
that was a very, very apocalyptic time, really, for all of us. I was going through some serious changes, musically, personality-wise, growing up, late adolescence, really. And he was involved in that. And we would talk to one another about who we were. And I think it's my first actual experience of sharing my life with someone like that at an age when intimacy is quite scary and frightening, you know. And he was very respectful. And he showed me respect and he showed me a great deal of love, you know. And we became kind of like brothers in a way.
Martin obviously needed something more than what was around, you know, the kind of the art and the friends. And he was living with Eric at the time, and Eric had mentioned about this guy in Greenwich Village called Tiny Tim.
And he had an old overcoat on and matted long curly hair. And a huge, he looked like Fagin to me. And I thought, what's this? And he had a sort of paper bag and it, with sort of sheet music in it and a ukulele. And he pulled out the ukulele and he started singing.
Life is just a trail, so the poets say. Who knows where it will end? And as we go through life, we all have need of friend.
I just went back to London with that thing tattooed on my brain, what I'd seen. And the first person I thought that I knew would appreciate this would be Martin's. And I told him
that you meet in childhood.
That night there was a concert at the Albert Hall. Somebody produced some very, very strong Nepalese hashish.
I'll never forget Martin. Martin was he was absolutely transformed after that concert.
Martin came out of it a changed man. He completely got it.
And his obsession with Tiny Tim started from that night.